Hello everybody, welcome to Nintendo Power Block. I am your host, Eddie V. Boss man himself, Mr. Corey Derrick, is on baby alert. Anytime the baby can arrive. So me and Jesse, my wife's Wisconsinite. Hey Jesse.
Hey, what's up, bud?
We're going to be able to give you guys a great show with good content. Got some good stories for you guys. And if you kind of was disappointed, well, there's been more announcements for game releases. So we're going to get into that in the later half. And then we're also going to get into a discussion that might seem concerning to some people, but not many. I'll explain later. But before we get into that, like I said, I'm your host, Eddie V. Jesse Douglas is joining me. We're going to get into what we've been playing, and I'm actually going to start because I think Jesse might need some time to think about what you've been playing.
Yeah. I mean, I kind of, like, lately it's been weird. I've been mostly only playing Switch, but this week I played, right at the end of the week here today, I played a little bit on Xbox, but. Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead first.
Well, for Switch, play some Breath of the Wild. Getting more further into that game. Just loving it. Got a little further in Just Chasing Beats. I picked it back up. And man, that game is so good. I kind of put it from the game could be evil, but I love how difficulty and how hard it is. Because it's just like you have to watch. And the thing about it is the beat is tempting you to move your head and dance to, but you gotta still kind of like, oh, I need to pay attention because a lot of that stuff is going on. So you gotta keep in touch with the patterns. Man, the soundtrack is still amazing. Just like the music is banging in. I'm getting further along in that game. Got a few more levels to go before I end up being it. Still just an interesting story and art style, and it's just like it's so good. And I was thinking about it, and I'm just like, I hope this game ends up getting a physical release. Because I don't know if it's going to be coming to other systems or anything. And I haven't heard of sales on Switch, but man, this game is just so good, and hopefully more people look forward to playing this game. Like, if you love Luminous and if you love music style games, man, Just Shapes and Beasts is just so good. It's so good that you just want to beg it in your car. Like, you want to take the Switch along with you just to hear the music and play, even though, you know, good and well, you can't really play it because you got to drive or you got to be on the bus or whatever. But it really is good. Play some more Ice Cream Surfer. I'm going to sit down and beat that game. I keep getting to like the third level and be like, okay, I had enough fun. It's goofy and stuff. But I think I'm going to sit down and actually go through that game and beat it. So that's what I've been doing, getting myself ready for Captain Toad, and getting ready for Octopath Traveler. I know I'm going to start off Octopath Traveler before I do Captain Toad, because I already like did like 2/3 of it on Wii U. And so I kind of know what to do when it comes to the Switch version. I just got to do the last few levels of it on Wii U. Which is going to be the same thing on Switch. But I'm interested in doing the Mario levels, for that game. So, looking forward to that. Some more Battle Chef Brigade, getting further into that, just enjoying it. Love the art style, love the voice acting and the comedy. I'm thinking of getting Overwatch, because Overwatch 2 is about to drop and I kind of want the collection. It just looks so fun and funny. And I, can you hear me, Jesse? Oh, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. What happened? I was just like...
It was on my end. I just, like, all of a sudden... Because I'm so used to using the wired controller.
Uh-huh.
And so it shut off on me.
Oh.
I didn't even notice it. So that was kind of my fault.
Okay. That's what I've been doing with Switch. I think after I get Spider-Man for PlayStation 4, and I'll get Battlefield 5, and I'll get Forza Horizon 4. After those two games, it's pretty much now, and once I get more money for my new job, pretty much now it's all Switch. Like, the rest of the year is going to be digital or physical games. Because I still need to go get Mario Aces Tennis, and Wolfenstein 2. I need to go and get those games and stuff. But the way the pay goes, it was kind of, I was just like, I can't do it. I got to pay a bill. And then my new paycheck is, like, part of it is going to cut the toll into Octopath and phone bill. And a little bit of other things. So hopefully by time that following check comes, I'll pick up Mario Aces and Wolfenstein 2. And then be ready for, like, Dead Cells and Okami HD. Like, get ready for my August games and stuff. While still picking back some of the backlog for that. So, yeah, like, for the rest of the year, it's Switch. It's literally Nintendo only. For PS4, I beat Mad Max. Now, I'm not going to go into detail. You guys are going to have to check out Wednesday's episode of Arsenal X. I'm going to leave it at that. I did beat the game, but I'm going to leave it at that for you power blockers. This is a family-friendly show. AX is whatever. So that's Arsenal X, everybody. But that's what I've been doing on PlayStation 4, which was really just Mad Max, finishing up my backlog for it. That's what I did with that. I'm thinking of jumping in Final Fantasy VII also for PlayStation 4. I brought it, and I also brought, which was cool. This is crazy, dude. So they had, Darksiders. The War Master Edition, for $2 on PlayStation 4, like for a flash. And I'm just like, yeah, cause I have Darksiders 2 on, PS4. Yeah. So I was just like, well, might as well get the collection. I'm like, it's only $2. So, but I'm going to start, Final Fantasy VII. And I need to get to Detroit Become Human, because I've been so hyped for that game. I got it and then didn't even start that game. So I'm going to be jumping into those two games. And then hopefully I can be ready for Spider-Man by the time it comes out. I'm trying to just work on doing a lot of games. For Xbox, I finally hooked up my Slim. My plan is, I was talking to Corey about this, is that I'm going to keep my Xbox One, my original, and I'm going to put it on, where I use my laptop. So it's going to be, like my laptop is going to be, it's going to be by my Xbox One, but the monitor that my laptop uses, I'm going to get a splitter for it. So that I could, when I'm not using my Xbox One, it'll be on the PC. But when I am using my Xbox One, it'll be on the split, it'll be on that, In case if I feel like, you know, not cutting on my ass, and I just need something quick to play and stuff. I'm going to keep it, because I think a lot of my games didn't transfer over because they're not on my external. Surprisingly, a lot of my, it's like a 94 games is on my external hard drive, and I still got more to put on. I had to re-put the Division on the system, so I gotta see how that goes. If not, then I'll just be playing it on the original Xbox, because we got a lot of progress on there, so I want to do that. Battlefield Hardlines, I'll be getting more into, because that's part of my backlog bash blowout for optional opinion. After that, I played some Destiny 2 a little bit. I started with a Titan. So now I have a Hunter, I have a Warlock, and now I have a Titan. So right now with my Titan and my Warlock, they're both at the first level. They're not like really strong or anything. So I'm going to be going through the whole games with that to get them up and everything. I didn't buy the DLC and stuff, so.
Yeah, I still need to do that too. I'll talk about it, but I noticed that there's certain guns and stuff you can't get unless you have the expansions.
Yeah.
Which I think is kind of stupid, but.
Well, you really can't play. It's one of those Activision things where you can't play with the other person unless you own the DLC. So you're literally locked out. So I just feel like, you know, I'll probably eventually get it. But I'm not going to get it now, because it's just like, you guys still are working on fixing this game to be better. And I'd rather wait till all the content comes and then just pay the season pass and get all that content. Because there's no reason for me that I spent $60 or 50 some dollars, because I think I got this game on the sale, to spend that much money, and then like 2/3 of that is the price for the DLC, for the season pass, and that season pass might not give me a lot of stuff. So I'd rather wait for all of that stuff to drop and everything. So, but I played a little bit of it. I played it on my Slim. So, I had to like kind of rearrange stuff. I actually started rearranging my games, my Xbox One games. Now I got to do my PS4 and my Wii U games. Just get that all arranged and stuff. Play some Ikaruga. I will jump back to Far Cry 5, probably next weekend. The way my schedule's looking, I'll probably be off Saturday. I gotta see how they're doing the schedule, because if they have me working, if they have me off Friday and Saturday, then I'm pretty much gonna be gaming that weekend and hopefully, do some recording and stuff like that. But pretty much that's all I've been, playing and been, getting into. So, I mean, those are the games that I've been touching on all three systems. Medios on my 2DS, Swing Golf I played, also my 2DS, and Fire Emblem Awakening I just started playing, and man, that game is still so good. Just love it. Just like, yes, love this game. So, but pretty much that's all I've been playing. So, but what about you, Jesse? What you been playing?
Yeah, I mostly I've been watching shows, but But it's, you know, like if I'm watching something, I can pull my Switch out, you know, and play that handheld, which is usually the way that I play my Switch nowadays anyways, or for the most part, even since I got it. Like really the only time I played the Switch in the dock was like if I was playing, like wanted to play Zelda on a bigger screen or something. Mm-hmm. But usually I barely ever play it on my TV. But yeah, so I've been playing I downloaded the demo of Captain Toad or whatever.
Yeah.
And so I played that. I finished the three levels or whatever that they have for you to try. And I liked it. You know, it's a you know, like one of those games that if you just like want to do something easy and you don't really want to have to think or really, you know, you like stress your brain out or anything, it's just kind of a fun little, you know, thing that you can kind of do at your own pace or whatever. And you know, I'm enjoying it. I probably will pick it up when it comes or when I get the money for it or whatever. Like, yeah, because it is out already then, right? Like the full game is out.
It'll be out Friday.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
This Friday.
That's what I thought. Okay. I was like, well, I think it comes out soon, but yeah.
Yeah.
So
Captain Toad and Octopath Traveler are both big releases this Friday. So.
Okay. Yeah, which, you know, that will work. I'm guessing a lot of people will buy both, but you know, like if people that have kids will probably get the Captain Toad because obviously Octopath Traveler is more of an adult game. Yeah. Like it's a little too much for kids to understand.
A lot of people said the review comes out Thursday. By the sounds of it, it looks like this might be a big contender for Game of the Year.
Yeah, Octopath Traveler.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see that. It's like just how in depth and in detail that demo was. Like that first demo even, you know, it's definitely like one of those games that I can see being a really big hit, so.
Yes.
And then I played some Fortnite, obviously. I play that pretty often on Switch. And like lately I've been playing it, you know, somewhat consistently.
Uh-huh.
Like now, like there's been a couple of times where like if I land and I get a really bad land where there's a whole bunch of people around me and I wasn't able to grab something, that I'll die right away. But lately I've been like finishing in the top four or top five, like almost every game. But I still cannot get that first place though. It's like one of the last games I played, I got second place. But like what happened was I was finishing off one guy, and their third guy that was left took advantage of that, and he took me out while I was, you know, in the process of getting the other guy. And because I had like a rocket launcher with like 16 rockets, and I was like fully loaded and ready to take on whoever, but I got unlucky and wasn't able to defend myself. Because as long as I'm going up one on one with someone in that game, like I almost always will come out, you know, the winner between the two of us. But my problem is a lot of the times I'll get team, you know, like even though it's everyone versus everyone, they'll go after, you know, someone will go after me. Because while I'm killing someone, it's like, okay, well, he's going to kill them anyway. So I'll shoot the person that, you know, shoot me. They shoot me instead of trying to get the person that's already dead.
Yeah.
So they can get the jump on me. So that's been my issue is I just a lot of the times I'm getting double teamed, and that's, you know, in the final three. And that's why I don't end up being able to win it all. Because I haven't been in that situation where there's the last two people are fighting each other and I'm watching and being the one to shoot at whoever. Because if it was that, you know, that situation, I think and that's probably what I'm going to need to win, unfortunately. But yeah, I mean, that game's fun. And And it's just so, you know, it's just so easy and nice to be able to pick up my Switch and just kind of play that while I'm watching a show or whatever. And, you know, it's just fun. As much as I love playing PUBG, you know, like that game is just kind of, it's just an easier, like a little easier to play. So, and then I've also been playing, I played some Mario Tennis with my son a little bit today. Like I was, cause he wanted my son Max wanted to play it today. And I'm like, well, it's a little hard, you know, a little bit harder, but you know, like you're going to have to learn stuff. You're not going to be able to just, you know, be good, you know, right away with it. And so he was just playing that open part where it's teaching you, like, you have to do this kind of shot at that wall.
Yeah.
You know, like, there's a wall, and then it will show which kind of shot you have to do and to hit it at the wall, and then that one will disappear, and then a new one will come down.
Uh-huh.
And so it's teaching you how to do the shots. And there is one shot. He's like, can you do this for me? I'm like, no, you gotta learn how. If I just do it for you, then you're not gonna learn how to do that shot. So you just, you know, keep trying. And I was trying, and I found out later I did end up helping him, but it was because I found out he was pushing the wrong button with the direction that he was supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
So then I, you know, I just told him what, you know, what he needed to do to get it right. And then he ended up getting it. But, yeah, that game's fun. It's not like a main game for me. It's just kind of one of those things that's like more like if my friends come over or, you know, is more of a, it's, yeah, it's more of a social game.
Okay.
Like for me, like the game that's coming out soon enough that I would play, or well, I don't know. I guess I don't know exactly when it's coming out, but like Mario Party, yeah. Like those kind of games, I'm more inclined to play by myself more often. You know, so like that when that comes out, I'll probably play that a lot and be working on trying to, you know, get unlock stuff. And if it's like the, you know, like the old school ones have always been, there's usually like as you progress through the game, you like get tokens or you get things to unlock stuff later or whatever. So I'll probably play that more often. But like the single player mode's good. I enjoy it. It's fun enough, you know. It's different, and you know, some of the things take a little figuring out because they don't quite, you know, explain things to you always. So, but you know, that's fun. So that's mostly what I've been playing on Switch, and then on Xbox today I played I started the what's it, Captain Spirit demo.
Yeah, I did too. I started that.
Yeah, did you? Yeah, that it's like I haven't gotten very far. I just got to the point of where like his dad like grabs a bottle and walks into the living room to watch TV. Like that's as far as I've gotten in it so far. So I just like just started that before you got home, before we started recording. So I actually forgot. Otherwise, I would have started it sooner.
Yeah,
I forgot that I downloaded it.
I think they said it's like 2 hours long. It's not that they said it's not too long.
Yeah, because I guess it's labeled as a demo, but technically it's a free to play game. Like because it's basically like a prequel, from what I understand, to the second game.
Yeah, so it's a prequel that's supposed to lead into the second game. But then I think that's why. I think it got like 8s and 9s. Like people, like I know Game Informer enjoyed it. And it kind of got some good praise for it. So, I'm with you. I can't wait to get through some more with that. I'll try like I said, Monday to do it in one sitting. Like I'll probably wake up in the morning and that'd be like the first game I play just to get through it all.
The podcasts, I listen to Xbox podcasts, my Xbox and Me or whatever. Mm-hmm. And they talked about it without spoiling anything. And they said it was like, it's definitely it's a tearjerker. Like if you've experienced some of the things that happen in the storyline of this Captain Spirit thing, that it definitely pull at your heartstrings. So yeah, I was like, well, I never even played the first game yet. I still haven't played the first Life is Strange or whatever. And so, like, I probably should go and play that. I think it's on game. No, I don't think it's on Game Pass.
No, because it's a free demo. Anyone could just download it.
Yeah. No, I mean the Life is Strange, the original Life is Strange game.
One. Oh yeah.
Yeah, because I have never played the first game, so I didn't know exactly what kind of game type it was. Like, I figured it was a story-driven game, but I didn't.
It is.
It's kind of more of a point-and-click.
It is a little bit at times point-and-click, but not so much. Because sometimes there's, like, quick-time events also. So
Okay. But, yeah, so I'm I've only played it a little bit. I'll probably have more to talk about it next week. Because I'll probably try to finish it before next week. And so, yeah, I've been playing that. I went back. I played some Destiny 2 as well today.
Mm-hmm.
And got some of my things leveled up a little bit higher than what they used to be and stuff. But it's still such a pain in the butt to try to level things up. Because, like, I'm at a level, I think I'm at level 304.
Yeah.
And it's still everything I get, like, in Ingrams and stuff like that is, like, 295 or something like that. So it's almost like a 10 level lower than what I already am on everything that drops. So I still kind of wish that they would fix that a little bit and make it more like most games, where as you progress and as your level goes up, that things slowly, go up as well that drop. But it seems like it's hard to get anything to drop at a higher level than it already is. So that's been my issue with the game since day one, since getting up to a high level, is they make it really difficult to just play the game and get stuff, that's higher than what you are. So I wish they would kind of change that a little bit or something. Something needs to be done with that, because now I think you can get up to like 350 or something like that, isn't it? I don't even know what the level cap is at now, but it's not dropping things for me at all that are higher, but whatever. It still will be fun to play like with other people, and then I probably won't care as much. But I played that. I played some World War II Call of Duty. Just felt like playing that a little bit. I haven't played it in a long time. And then I played some State of Decay 2 earlier this week.
Nice.
So, I still like that game, but at the same time, it's like one of those games that I've really got to be in the mood for.
Yeah.
Like, because, like, it can be very stressful at times, that game, because you can get bombarded with, like, zombies, and if you're not, like, I was having issues where, like, my people, like, when I first started my game recently, like, a lot of my players were tired and worn out, so their stamina bars and everything barely would fill up. Like, you know how the game does that, where, like, once you're a person is exhausted, like, their stamina bar won't fill up all the way.
Yeah.
It will only go a certain way. And so that's what I started out with, a bunch of my people like that. And so I didn't want to switch to the people that weren't, you know, that weren't exhausted, because there was something that I was trying to do at the time. And so I just kind of, I played it a little bit and then I just put it down. I made those people that were exhausted sleep so they would regain their stamina and stuff like that. And then just ended up shutting the game off and playing something else. But
yeah, I gotta start rescuing more people and find like a bigger place and try to get more food. Like I need to play the game and do a lot of trial and error. Just be like, okay, let me die. Okay, let me get this person. Let me do this. So I, you know, just gotta work through that game.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely something that I've got to work on as well.
Yeah. So, well, anything else you've been playing?
That's pretty much it. I plan on starting Resident Evil 7 pretty soon here.
Is that on Game Pass, or did you pick it, or did you buy it?
I ended up buying it. I bought it at one of the local places that and they had it for $15. So
okay, yeah, that's a game that I need to finish too. I was supposed to do that for a review for something, and someone else got the game and finished it, and they were going to do the review, but it never happened. So I'm just like, okay, that's fine.
Yeah. So,
well, everybody, that's been what we've been playing. We're going to actually get into the news. And a very big announcement, like, literally happened. Panic Button is porting the online co-op hit Warframe to Nintendo Switch. Canadian developer and publisher Digital Extremes has revealed that Warframe is in development for Nintendo Switch thanks to a partnership with Panic Button. The news comes from this year's TinoCon, the third annual convention for the game. Warframe is a third-person, free-to-play online action game set in the evolving sci-fi world, giving players the chance to master the Warframe armor as the enigmatic. Tenno, a race of ancient warriors who are awakened from centuries of Kairosleep by the mysterious god Lotus. The game features more than 35 unique Warframes, hundreds of weapons, and thousands of customization options, as well as upgrades, a flexible mod system, and the ability to join clans, nurture pets, and explore massive new worlds. The game was originally released on PC back in 2013, arriving on PS4 and Xbox One shortly after, and it has seen regular updates and tweaks since then to keep things fresh. Being the ambitious title that it is, it comes as little surprise that Digital Extremes wanted to get Panic Button on board with the Switch version. Panic Button's recent ports of Doom, Wolfenstein 2, The New Colossus, and Rocket League have all impressed, so we're feeling hopeful for another success story here. Of course, Panic Button recently teased that a major Switch port will be announced this month, and it seems like we now have our answer as to what that game is. No release window has been confirmed for the title just yet, but here are a few, and if you guys want to see the screenshots, you can see that in Nintendo Live, which all our stories will be coming from for this episode. That's big.
Yeah.
With Warframe. And I'm just going to say this, because even with Paladin dropping, and that probably having some problems, but they're working on the fixing that stuff, Blizzard is now in Blizzard's hand to bring Overwatch. I know we're not going to get PUBG. That's fine, but because we got Fortnite. But Fortnite, Warhammer, Warframe, because that is a big title. And Paladins and stuff, and some more of them that's coming and stuff. It's time for Blizzard to be like, you know what? We got to up the ante. We have got to get Overwatch on Switch.
Yeah.
Because go ahead.
I was going to say, and with Warhammer, like, from what I heard, that's more of like a Destiny-style game, isn't it? Like
Warframe, yeah.
Yeah, so like, so that, you know, since, you know, we'd never see Destiny on a you know, Nintendo or on Switch, you know, it's kind of like, you know, that'll be a nice little alternative. And like, I've heard people say that they think War Frame is better than Destiny anyways. So, I mean, like, you know, like, so Switch is not only getting a Destiny style game now that you can play on the Switch, but it's also, you know, free to play. So,
well, even if it's free to play, if they could do cross play with Xbox One and PC later on down the road, that's a good sale. I will happily, if they be like, okay, the trial version is free to play, but if you want the full experience with this, it's $40. I would pay the $40 if it plays good. And, you know, Panic Button does a good, you know, they're great at porting games. Wolfenstein 2, every time I look at that, I'd be like, yes, I do own this on Xbox One, but how in the heck did you still got this game working on Switch and it still looks good? Like, it has some minor graphical things, that's fine, but I'm just like, the frame rate doesn't look jacked up.
Yeah.
I'm like, and so Panic Button is not only becoming like the go-to port company, gamers are going to Panic Button to buy their games.
Yeah.
You know. And so they're coming like the big, like they're coming like the big third party porting company, and people are down for that. And I think whenever they announce their own game that they're working on, if it comes to Switch, people are going to buy it. You know, they also talked about they want to do the New Order for Switch. I think when they get done with Warframe, I think Bethesda's going to let them do it.
Yeah. Well, and I think the thing is, you know, like it seems like Panic Button is basically the company that's reliable when it comes to doing a little bit more you know, ambitious games, you know, like ports, because like from what I remember, I haven't played a whole lot of Warframe, but like the little bit that I remember, because I started a save or whatever, and it's a pretty decent looking game. Like the graphics and everything are, you know, are pretty good. So I'm curious to see what it's going to look like on Switch, you know, after they do it. So it should be good. It's kind of like one of those things that Switch doesn't quite have, like one of those games of service or whatever type games yet, like that, you know, that's more MMO or whatever kind of type game. So,
and if it does, I'll say 2 or 3 million, just like Fortnite did. Like if it does a big thing, I think Activision and Blizzard's going to have to watch to be like, y'all got no choice to bring Overwatch or bring a Destiny style game, because at this point in time, Switch is just, I'm like, the people who are doing the stuff that you are avoid of bringing, they're going to end up making that money.
Yeah. Well, and like I said, like I think the way Warframe works is that the game itself is free, but then like you can pay for certain things, like if you want to get stuff or whatever. I don't know a whole lot about it, but so I mean, just the fact that I don't know if they're gonna end up charging for Switch, or if it's gonna be free to play like it is everywhere else on there as well. I'm not sure, I guess.
Yeah.
But like if that's the case, that it's free to play on there just like everywhere else, that, you know, that'll be pretty big, because, you know, like that's something that you'd be able to use your Switch for, and you don't even really have to, you know, buy anything. So, you know, like as far as you know, like younger people and stuff playing it, not having to spend any money, you know, that'll be pretty big. So, And yeah, I hope they do have cross play, because that would be pretty, that would be a perfect game to use cross play on.
And even if they have to charge for cross play, meaning like if it's part of, hey, you know, we did all this work and, you know, if you guys are want to support us, and I'm like, we want to do crossplay, but if you guys could buy parts of the game or it's part of this update and stuff, and you're just supporting us with, you know, payments and stuff, we'll be gladly to do it. Like, if it was connected to like a future DLC, I would pay $10 or $20, yeah, or whatever the season pass or whatever it takes to bring crossplay to the system. Hopefully people do pick up this game for Switch and support it, like financially support it. So, but we're going to move on to the next two games that kind of was announced. Two spooky titles published by Axie Games are coming to Switch. During the panel at 2018 Anime Expo in Los Angeles, Axis Games revealed the scary 2D side-scrolling adventure Ghost Parade will arrive on the Nintendo Switch in 2019. Developed by the Indonesian-based studio Lentera, Ghost Parade tells the story of a girl named Suri who is lost in a forest and must find her way back home. Mythical ghosts offer to aid her, provided she helps them stop a bunch of humans who are attempting to destroy the forest. Throughout the journey, you'll take control of many different ghosts, all with unique abilities. There are also combo skills to master, item crafting, and a variety of bosses to take on. Axie Games also announced Experiences Horror adventure titled Deathmark. It is currently being localized for the Switch and is expected to be released soon. This latest iteration is based on the PS Vita release and will include all content plus an additional episode. In this universe, unknown body markings are killing people, with the belief an individual who came into contact with the ghost gave humanity the curse. The game takes place in a mansion set to protect those who have been marked, and you, as the protagonist, have lost your memory. So, those two games are coming. You know, the arrival of survival horror, I guess. I'm kind of interested because I've never played a game from India. I don't think Moon Studios might count in a way with Ori and the Blind Forest, but that was a collaboration of people around the world. I just haven't actually played, you know, people in India who created a video game company to make a game for just Nintendo or just for a system, for them to be picked up by a company like Axis or Axies. So I'm interested. I've never heard of Experiences. I've never heard of Deathmark, but I'm down to give it a try, because we don't have really no survival horror. Resident Evil Revelations 1 and 2, I guess, but like, we don't have anything that's like on the verge of like a Silent Hill or Resident. Well, not Resident Evil.
The closest would probably be Outlast, right?
Yeah, Outlast. Yeah.
That's probably about it. Like, it's, I mean, you know, like you said, other than like Resident Evil, but that's about it. You know, and that's an older game. So,
yeah. And I don't know if you're into survival horror games, Jesse.
I love Resident Evil and stuff, and I mean, those are, I guess they're kind of survival horror, but I'm trying to think, like, what are some other ones that would be considered survival horror that Until Dawn is more of like a storytelling like type thing. Mm-hmm. I don't think that would be considered a survival horror, but I mean, yeah, I like like anything that basically that's horror, a lot of the times I end up liking. So like I still haven't gotten too deep into Outlast, but I do own the first one on my PC and on Xbox, I think. Mm-hmm. So, but
yeah, I need to pick it up. I played a little bit of the demo on Xbox One, on the original one. And I'm kind of interested in getting all three games, like getting that Outlast collection.
I definitely would like to get into that eventually one of these days. I just, like, at the time when I got it, I could play it on my PC or whatever, but it wasn't really, my PC wasn't, like, the greatest in the world, so, like, it was kind of, like, choppy. I had to play it at the lowest settings or whatever, but I do have it on Xbox, though, now, so I got it shortly after. But, as far as these games, like, the one Ghost Parade.
Yeah.
Like, that, like, I seen some, like, images and stuff of it. And that, like, I really like the art style that they have on that game.
Yeah, I just found out that they just got announced, so I haven't had a chance to look it up. But I'm very interested. I'm very intrigued. Go ahead, Jesse.
I was gonna just say it's similar to, like, not really similar, but like the stuff that I've seen, the pictures that I've seen, the color palette is similar to like Ori, where it's like kind of darks and like really the really bright, like light up like greens and blues and stuff. Yeah. Like, it's not really like that, it somewhat reminds me of like Ori and the Blind Forest type.
It has
of
a clean kind of hand drawn, not watercolor, but like a. I'll have to look at it, but it has like an animated style to it, I'm assuming.
It's like definitely. It's, yeah, like, definitely, like, an anime type, but I don't know, it's just really cool looking. Yeah, once you get a chance to look at some of the pictures of it, I think you'll dig it, too, so.
Okay.
But, so, I'm kind of interested in that game. It looks kind of fun, so.
Well, everybody, Axie Games also announced another title for Switch at that same panel. They announced Stardust Galaxy Warriors Stellar Climax. This game will be coming also to Switch in the new near future. It is a shooter. It's a shmup, like a 2D level-based shmup. As a member of the New Galactic Police Force, your task is to restore peace and order to the universe by unleashing bullet hell in a gigantic mech suit. The 2015 release featured local co-op for up to 4 players, 5 unique mechs, 49 weapon combinations, a 10-level campaign, endless gauntlet and challenge modes, customizable gameplay, and an amazing soundtrack. And the trailer is available for you guys to see how it looks. This is a day one purchase. I love shoot 'em up bullet hell games, and just like it feels like the 90s in a sense.
Yeah.
Where shoot 'em up games were just like everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, and I like like even on Super Nintendo and stuff like that. Yeah, like that was pretty big, like was it Gradius or whatever, and all those kinds of games?
One of the biggest ones that I still love to do this very day is Aero Flash on Sega Genesis.
Aero Flash,
yeah. The soundtrack.
I can't remember what that other one that I just recently had bought for Super Nintendo is. I forget what it's called, but yeah, I bought some stuff like that.
Not Axelay. Well, Axelay, I actually have it on Wii U.
Yeah,
that's the first time I never played Axelay. I think it's Phalanx. It's some guy had a beard playing a banjo on a cover, and it's an airplane in the game. Look at it. It's Phalanx. I think it's Phalanx, something like that. It was a weird cover, but the game was kind of awesome. Sometime in the future, I'm definitely picking this game up. Like, I've never heard of it, so I'm intrigued to play. And then when I found it out, when I looked at it a little bit, I'm like, this is definitely coming in my library. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'd like to get some more of those type of games in my library too, because I do like those kind of games, and I've been like actively watching for games like that for a couple of years now, but I just, you know, for whatever reason, like, it goes back to that thing that I have kind of an issue with, like, with so many people just trying to do the old school, you know, like, pixelated, you know, graphics and stuff, and yeah. It's like, I want to see stuff done in like the, you know, like more futuristic, more up-to-date graphics, because like those kind of games like would just look so amazing and like, you know, nowadays graphics, and I just hate when certain games that could be so much better in upgraded graphics, you know, get put in the old school graphics. So, and those kind of games, because if I want to play those kind of games and those graphics, and yeah, I'll play them the Super Nintendo games or the game, you know, like, that's how I feel. I'd rather have newer stuff, and then if I want to play them in that graphics, I'll go back and play the old stuff.
I think if Konami, I want to play Parodius from Konami.
Parodius, I don't know if I've seen that one.
It's a play on the Gradius games, and then they got one of them called Sexy Parodius. Look it up. just look it up. It's a parody. It's kind of very comedic, but it is a shoot 'em up. And it never came to America, but people have found ways to play that game, and I believe it at that. But I would love to have a digital version come to America. Even if I had to do the little trick account of getting, you know, making a Japanese account so I could get it on my Switch, I would love for that to happen. Because you really don't need to read anything in Chinese or Japanese.
Yeah.
It's a shoot 'em up. You're there for the challenge to shoot 'em up. But we're going to get to our last story before we get into like a quick discussion. Zero Escape director unveils AI, the Somnium Files, a detective adventure coming to Switch. This is confirmed for a worldwide release also. There is a trailer, but I haven't got a chance to check it out yet. Zero Escape series director and scenario writer Kotaro Uchikoshi has unveiled AI The Somnium Files, a detective adventure game that will be released worldwide on Nintendo Switch. In the game, you'll be investigating the mystery behind a series of murders in a technologically advanced modern-day Tokyo, Japan. The game begins with a bizarre murder case where a body is found with the eye gouged out of the skull. A nice cheery start then. Playing as a detective named Kaname Date, you'll be on the trail of the serial killer behind the murder. Date's left eye is artificial with an AI unit inside that he used to solve crimes. Yusuke Kozaki, Fire Emblem Awakening No More Heroes, is the lead character designer for the title, and Kotaro Uchikoshi is known for his work on games such as Zero Escape, Punchline, and Ever 17, The Out of Infinity, often writing unconventional plot twists and offbeat humor. During the game's reveal presentation, which took place at the Spike Chunsoft Anime Expo, Uchikoshi also revealed a second character named Iris, a high school student YouTuber who creates her own series of Let's Play videos. The game doesn't have a confirmed release date just yet, but we'll make sure to keep an eye out for more news as it comes. Like I said, all of this news comes from Nintendo Life. I need to play the Zero Escape games. They said they're really, really good, and every time I see people play, talk about the Zero Escape or like 999 and stuff like that, I get happy. Only reason why I didn't get to play it and everything is it's one of those games that, yeah, it might be available digital, but I want to buy that physical, and not many stores carried it. And if they did carry it, it was a limited copy. So I may have to go back and just buy the game digitally. But this game, it's screaming hotel room 212, hotel dust room 212 or something like that. Hotel Dust is what I personally call it, which I would love to see that game come to Switch.
Now, so what kind of game type is it?
It's a detective adventure game. I think it's going to probably be like almost point and click. Probably almost like if you think of games like Snatcher or Phoenix Wright, like the original ones, where you go around. It just says, a detective adventure game. So it will have a adventure game, but you're being a detective. So you might be collecting clues and stuff like that. So we shall see.
Yeah. I know you said one of the creators of the gnome, was it the No More Heroes or whatever?
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's the spin-off of that game came out to Switch, wasn't it?
No More Heroes, no. No More Heroes is Suda 51.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Zero Escape comes from like 999 and stuff like that. They're like adventure kind of games came to the 3DS and to PlayStation. And you know, like Danganronpa and stuff like that. It's like a Japanese kind of survival horror detective adventure games and stuff.
But this
one, it just sounded like if you Snatcher is a game that Hideo Kojima made for the full version for Sega Genesis, because it added the last chapter that none of the previous Snatcher games had. So it's an adventure game in that kind of style. And that was kind of based off of Blade Runner, or inspired by Blade Runner, I should say. This might be something like on that vein, but we don't know yet. I haven't seen much from it, but it just got announced. So that's five games that's been announced for Switch, and this is after E3. So we're looking for stuff for it to this year and next year. So there's going to be games. But do you have anything else to say about that? Because this kind of have a connection about what we're going to just probably discuss probably about for like 7-10 minutes.
Yeah, no, I don't like I'd have to see more, like, because I personally I'm not really too big of a fan of like the you have like a lot of those those Japanese style games like our point and click type stuff where you're like searching for things and rooms, and like I don't know if it's going to be something like that, but I guess I'd have to see more of it to know whether it's something I'd be interested in, but yeah. So
well like Hotel Dust was what came from Nintendo published it. But a different company did. There was a sequel to it, but it never came to America. I think if you anyone who's played the Telltale games and like Batman, the Telltale Adventure, you probably could get an idea of what this game might be.
It would be more like that then, you think? Like more of like a, more like a Telltale game. Okay.
Yeah, probably.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
But like I said, I'm waiting for more information to see more. It'll probably be a day one purchase for me. I'll probably be, you know, putting money to the side to be like, you know what? I need to get this game and make sure that I be at Target at 8 o'clock, 8:30. Be like, I need you to put this game out. I need my game out. And now, reason why I brought up all five of these stories and bring up all of these games is that, and like I said, it's going to be probably about 17 minutes for this discussion. You know, there was a investor, kind of like a stock drop for Nintendo, from a lot of investors because they're kind of concerned or worried. And this happens in the stock market for everybody, about, you know, Nintendo not having enough games for the holiday in the future. And they probably was looking at how people responded to Nintendo at E3 with them bringing only, pretty much focusing a lot on Smash, and Kimishima, you know, he's still president of Nintendo, temporary president of Nintendo of Japan, and you know, he had to present a lot of stuff to the investors, and he probably haven't revealed the full plans on what they got coming. So with people kind of being disappointed with E3, and you know, Nintendo with Reggie Fils-Aimé saying that we got more stuff to announce this year, we're just not announcing them, not ready yet. Knowing that these five games are coming, and Nintendo pretty much having a pack like holiday, do you think that this little drop of investment, you know, it's not so much a roadblock, but do you think that this should put concern for Nintendo, or do you think those investors just need to see how things play out? Because if games and stuff like are being announced, like five games being announced within a week, and then more games being announced within a couple of days, like even by Monday, we could get five more games being announced. Do you think that investors, and let's just say people who are ready to get a Switch and owners of Switch, do you think that there should be some concern for the Switch?
Well, I personally think it's kind of like you had touched on. I think it's just more to do with maybe the E3. Like, I know that, like, E3 is kind of changing now, and it doesn't seem to quite be the same that, like, you know, as focused as it used to be on investors. Mm-hmm. Like investors still use it to, you know, to make decisions, but it used to be literally just targeted towards them mainly.
Yes.
And not, you know, and like us watching it was just kind of you know, like an extra bonus thing or whatever that we got to do. But I think it's probably, you know, like it's probably something to do with that. And I think like Nintendo, like they were like, they're, you know, they're trying to keep you know, a constant flow of new stuff coming out.
Yes.
But you know, I think they just got to focus on that and just to continue trying to, you know, offering new stuff coming out. And I think they should be fine. I think it was just kind of a lull, you know, because of the E3 and how, like, a lot of people just felt like it was like there was like it was kind of a letdown, just because they're so, you know, they're, I think the comparing it to last year, you know, like when everything was like just in your face, like nonstop new stuff coming out, and then E3, it was pretty slow compared to that. And I think because it's a new system, and it, you know, it's only a little over a year old now, people were expecting it to be filled with games again this year.
Yeah.
And when that didn't happen, I think maybe some people may have gotten worried, and that's what you've seen. But ultimately, I don't think it's going to be that big of an issue. I don't remember correctly, but I thought I heard something about Sony's stock dropping too after E3. I don't know. I don't remember.
I think so.
Because I know a lot of people were, you know, much like Nintendo's, a lot of people were disappointed with Sony's, you know, like that, you know, it was good for the people that were fans of, like, you know, like The Last of Us, but other than, you know, fans of The Last of Us, they're, you know, Sony didn't really have too much to offer as far as the future goes, you know, so I a lot of people kind of felt the same way with Sony's. And so, like, I could see that, you know, that being an effect as well for them of a stock drop. But, yeah, like, ultimately, I don't think Nintendo has too much to worry about. I think as long as they, you know, do what they're doing right now, they're kind of, you know, just focus on stuff that's coming. And, you know, even if it's not, you know, first party stuff, you know, and they focus on some of the bigger things like Warframe and stuff like that coming to Switch. Like, I think that's their main thing, is they just got to show like that they're getting a lot of third party support, and I think that will, you know, make all the difference for them, is just to let people know that when a third party game comes out that looks really good, that it's not necessarily a for sure thing that it's not going to come to Switch, you know? So I think that's their big thing, is that they just got to make sure that they push those third parties and let people know that, hey, you know, people are trying to make their games for our system too. I think that's important.
And
so,
it feels that with a lot of Nintendo games and indie games that come to the Switch, not many of them are becoming backlogs. You know, yeah. 200 people are buying this indie game, and, you know, good sales are reported, and people are finishing them and enjoying them.
Yeah,
I know we talk about, you know, sometimes a length of a game doesn't make it number one or make it the biggest thing if there's other things that hinders it. Just because the game is long, there could always be some problems. A lot of people who've been playing a lot of indie games, and some of even the big titles, they have been enjoying their time with it. And an indie game that might be six hours, if you do a straight playthrough, you know, dying, doing your trial and error, sometimes could become weeks because there's so much other content that's coming that you just jump around and you just add more and more to your backlog and stuff. You know, whatever you pay for a $60 game, you could end up probably having 4 or 5 indie games on Switch. And more, like I said earlier, more stuff can be announced. Now, with E3, people are disappointed in Nintendo because they didn't have, like, a big blowout. That's fine. Nintendo didn't have to do any of that. Once again, Microsoft has to try to get, and definitely with me being as a host of AX, I gotta be real sometimes, and I'd be like, Microsoft needed to win E3 this year, and in my eyes, they kind of did well. I think Nintendo still won E3, but Microsoft did their job of getting people to own an Xbox One. Yes, it is coming to PS4, but to show off those games more at Xbox says a lot of stuff, saying that they're taking third party and just games in general seriously. Where Sony is playing it, Sony had to show what is it from their first party that's been in long development, that's had delays, that they haven't shown for almost years or months and stuff, that gonna make people want to be interested in buying that game. you know.
Yeah.
So Sony has it easier because they think just because we're in the league with 70 plus PS4s, we don't have to do the work. You have to do the work, because if people are not getting anything out of your conference that they want to buy those games, then everybody's going to be like, okay, Sony's not really, now it's getting to a point that Sony's not really trying. Go ahead.
I think ultimately what happened with the Sony conference is the same thing that a lot of people who don't like Xbox, and they, you know, like one of the things that they say Xbox does too, like Microsoft does too much with their announcing games, I feel like Sony did, and that's only announcing stuff for the people that are only interesting to the people who already have a PlayStation, and not like enough variety to get people interested in, you know, that don't have a PlayStation to get a PlayStation. And I think that's something that Microsoft did correctly with the E3, is they showed like different kinds of games that, you know, all different people would like. And like the same with Nintendo, like they may not have showed like a lot, and there was a lot of things that people would have liked to see more about that, you know, that's from last E3 that they had mentioned was being made and then didn't talk about at all this year. I think, you know, I think that was part of the issue with the Nintendo thing, but at the same time, at least they had, you know, like a lot of the stuff that they did show though was something kind of for everyone, you know, like that everyone could be interested in. So, you know, like that, I think that ultimately was the only thing that really, like, in my opinion, that made Nintendo's E3 interesting at all this year, is just like, you know, like I, like people like me who've been hoping for a better, you know, a good Mario Party game again, you know, that we got that. And, you know, and to get to hear about, you know, the Star Fox stuff for that new game, the, what is it called? I can't think of it off the top of my head. So what is it? The game that Star Fox was going to be in.
Yeah.
So I can't remember what it's called, but what's the game that Star Fox was going to get added to again? I always forget the name of it.
Starlink?
Yeah, Starlink, yeah. Like, stuff like that, like, you know, like, it was good to see more of that stuff, but I don't know. I think Nintendo would be fine, but it just, I think, you know, as long as they keep announcing stuff like this, you know, in their Nintendo Directs and things like that, and give the investors and people more updates on like Metroid and stuff like that, you know, sometime soon. I think as long as they do that kind of stuff, they can kind of pull it back together. But if they, you know, if they don't kind of talk about any of that stuff anymore for too long, I could see it being an issue. But yeah. other than that, I mean, I think they'll be fine.
Yeah, I think Nintendo will be fine. I think once they see Switch sales pick up, and I think more success stories such as games just selling and being on their list and stuff, the APD list and everything. And even with Labo still selling well and, you know, maintaining and consistent and stuff and updating, I think Nintendo is still in a good spot. They got all that cash in the bank. They got so much money. People don't realize that if anything happens to Nintendo and people think they could close down, they have so much stock invested. I mean, just money literally that's theirs, that's in the bank. That could be like, well, Nintendo has failed. We could come back within 6 months and we start all over if they wanted to, or pay off whatever they need to pay. Like, Nintendo is so big around the world that, you know, they just have a their business smart. The business had to evolve at one point in time, but they are business smart. You could hate Nintendo for a whole bunch of other stuff. You could say this E3 was terrible, but if you've seen that more games are being announced for Nintendo Switch compared to PS4 and Xbox One, and people are giving Nintendo more guaranteed sales for that, and these are not pre-orders. These are just people saying that I'm going to buy the game, and they're buying the game that the day it comes out. That's good news. You know, people always said that, you know, like I did my first digital pre-order was Ikaruga. But everybody is just so too physical for Switch that the Switch text or whatever, people don't even care anymore. They would pay $30 or $40 to get that. When limited run games, when all of that stuff is sold out on Switch, that just shows the popularity of how that system is. Not many people are talking big about Microsoft and Sony at this time. They will talk about them later on in the year. No doubt about that. Definitely when Game of the Year nominations come up. There's no doubt that, you know, people are going to be talking a lot about Sony and talking about Microsoft. But you cannot deny, and like I stated, ever since maybe April, and probably, I'll probably even say March, ever since earlier this year that games have been released on Switch, there has been a constant flow of great titles that people have been enjoying and talking about. I've been trying to tell people about Iconoclast on PS4, trying to warn people to, like, I hope people play this game. And I don't know how it did on PS4. When Iconoclast, I feel like when that dropped for Switch, it's going to get a lot of people interested in playing that game. And hopefully a physical version comes out. Because this game was done by one person. 8 years done by one person, and to see that it not even get mentioned because of Celeste, you know, I think once that game hits Switch, I think it'll be better sales and more people will talk about it. I'll definitely will buy it.
So, yeah.
But everybody, go ahead.
I was just going to say one last thing too, that I think that maybe Nintendo should have did that could contribute to the stock drop as well, or like, you know, like people losing a little bit interest, is I kind of wish too that they would have talked a little bit about their online service and stuff, and like maybe you know, mention what that's going to include and stuff like that, because that's supposed to be rolling out fairly soon, isn't it?
What,
the online service?
Yep, September.
So, like I was kind of surprised that they didn't really talk much about what's going to be included with that, you know, like a little bit more in detail.
I think we'll get a breakdown, like Nintendo Direct in September, or next month in August.
Yeah, but I mean, still, just like from an EA standpoint, I feel like that would have been kind of something that they should have maybe talked about during that, but. Just because, like, again, like with the whole investors type thing, like, you know, like, because like I said, though it's kind of drifting away from being about investors, and I don't know, maybe they did before EA started, because it sounds like a lot of the investor type stuff gets done before the EA even starts.
Yes.
But it would have kind of been nice, though, if they did talk about it, for them to talk about it a little bit for the people who own the Switches as well, you know, not just investors. But I don't know, you know, like that's one thing that I thought about later after E3 was, you know, said and done, and you could kind of, you know, like think about, okay, well, what would I have really thought would have been, you know, important for them, you know, to talk about. And that was one of the things that I thought of, that I was kind of like, you know what? That's right. They didn't really talk about that. And it kind of would have been nice if they did. But,
right.
But you know, if that's something that they hopefully are going to talk about soon, then, you know, I feel like that could make a lot of difference as well. But overall, you know, like I said, there could be so many games that we don't even know about that are being made or have, you know, already finished for the Switch that they haven't, they're just doing the finishing touches for, because, you know, that's something that we've seen since the Switch came out, is that we could all of a sudden one day wake up and like all of a sudden there's all these games that are going to be coming out in the next, you know, couple of months or whatever, you know, like the, as far as indie games go and stuff like that. So, because I mean, who knows, they could have another Lightfall or something like that that's coming out. Yeah. I mean, there's so many games that they showed during last E3 that we've seen absolutely nothing about yet, you know. So I mean, there's still a lot that still is in development, you know.
Right. How the heck they going, like, what, I think Metro's next year too?
Like, yeah.
Like, Metro Exodus was like, you showed us last year, and it's still not, well.
Yeah. Well, but that's it. Nowadays, games take, you know, four to five years to finish, because, you know, as the tech gets better, they come up with more and more stuff that they want to try to do in their games.
I think it gets problematic when you're not showing actual gameplay controller wise. That's the stuff that you're going to see on your TV screen, because it looks good. Like, and I think that's why Digital Foundry and a lot of people do all these comparisons about what you show at E3 compared to what you show, what's being like the real game. It's always going to be two different things, and people are, that's something people are just like, that's why everybody enjoys Nintendo Conference, because what you see there is what you're going to get.
Yeah.
No. So,
yeah.
But that's going to be the show, everybody, for Nintendo Power Block. I have been your host, ADV, Jesse Douglas. He has joined me on this long and wild episode. Once again, like I said, our boss man, Corey Derrick, is on Baby Alert, so shout out to him. Me and Jesse are even standing by, just like, oh, boss, you know, making sure that everything is okay. But if you guys want to find more about Nintendo Power Block, you guys can find us on YouTube at our Nerds Gone Rogue, and also check out ngrradio.com, where we have a lot of content and other shows. Also check out our Facebook page, Nintendo Power Block. And I believe you can email the show at NintendoPowerBlock@gmail.com. Sorry if I got it wrong, everybody. Normally Corey does all the plugs and stuff, and I just sit back and everything. You can find me on Twitter at ThatBretroCo, and you can also check out my podcast, Optional Opinion, on SoundCloud, iTunes, Google Play, TuneIn, and other podcast apps. Jesse, where can we find you?
You can find me on Twitter, and I actually changed mine, so it's Phantom Maggot AX at Phantom Maggot AX.
That's MAGGOT.
Yeah, yep, and there's no space. The P in Phantom is capital, and the M in Maggot is capital, and then capital AX, no spaces in all of it. So
yeah. And so, everybody, once again, have a great week, have a great weekend, and we'll see you next time on Nintendo Power Block. Bye, everybody. Woohoo!
Bye. I didn't realize how late it was already.